Good evening, everyone. We will talk today about an important topic. And here we begin in Vienna, and where the first percutaneous precursor in human was done by Dr. Franz Schuh in 1840 in Vienna for a young lady, 24-year-old, with mediastinal tumor, and she survived. After that, for 5 months, where autopsy confirmed the diagnosis of mediastinal tumor, which was the cause of the effusion in her case. The procedure was done by a trocar introduced into the left third intercostal space that time. And after a few years later, in 1911, in Paris, the famous Dr. Marfan performed the first percutaneous subxiphoid approach. So what is the indication of precardiocene? First, we have emergency indication, most importantly cardiac tamponade, which is the most common indication, followed by semi-urgent indication, where we have to know a specific cause of the effusion, which might alter the treatment plan, like in the cases of bacterial or neoplastic or TB pericarditis. And then we have elective indication in case of severe symptomatic pericardial effusion persistent despite medical treatment after 3 months, or persistent after adequate dialysis in CKD patient. Normally, the pericardium is formed by inner visceral layer and outer fibrous layer, and containing about 25 mm of fluid, and the pressure inside it is less than 5 mm. What actually happened in cardiac tamponade is this fluid increase in the volume and in pressure, causing a pressure like 15 to 20 millimeter mercury. The high intrapericardial pressure actually bending the LV and the RV filling, and causing decreased cardiac output, which become causing the famous Beck's triad of impaired venous return, causing descended neck veins, and low cardiac output causing hypotension. And indeed, this pericardial fluid damping the heart sound, causing muffled heart sound. And we have also in the pulse of the patient a characteristic feature, which is exaggerated drop of the blood during inspiration, more than 10 millimeter mercury. What is called Balthus paradoxus. We might have also electrical alternance with alteration of the voltage of the ECG of the patient. So cardiac tamponade is a phenomena dependent on the rate of accumulation of fluid rather than the volume of fluid itself, so that we might have as few as 50 cc of pericardial fluid, enough to cause rapid rise in the intrapericardial pressure and causing symptomatic tamponade. On the other hand, in chronic patients, the compliance of pericardium might accommodate more fluid up to 1000 cc before causing tamponade. So cardiac tamponade pulse of physiology independent on the rate of accumulation of fluid rather than the volume of fluid. Then how to assess pericardial effusion in different echocardiographic view. It should be measured at the end of diastole, and then grading of effusion according to the volume, with mild for less than 1 cm effusion, moderate between 1 and 2 cm diameter, and severe for effusion more than 2 cm. But what actually matter, as we discussed before, is the hemodynamic significance of the effusion rather than the volume of effusion itself, which can be assessed on the effect on the filling of the RV and LV. Here in the apical four-chamber view, and during while the valves are open, we are here in diastole. If we saw this, if we see this picture with RV collapse while the valve is open in diastole, this is an early sign of tamponade. And then assessing the flow across the mitral and tricuspid valve with variation in mitral inflow more than 25% or in the tricuspid valve more than 40% is indicative of tamponade. This can easily be measured by getting apical four chamber view and plotting the pulsed wave Doppler cursor at the tip of mitral and tricuspid valve respectively, and then measure the variation between the smallest and the tallest waves exceeding 25% as we just told over the mitral valve denoting tamponade, and exceeding 40% over the tricuspid valve denoting also early signs of tamponade. So what is the contraindication procedure? Being a life saving condition, so it has no absolute contraindication, but all are relative contraindication, including bleeding abnormalities like low platelet count below 50 thousandths, or abnormal anticoagulation caused by abnormally high INR, or if the patient already on anticoagulation. But as we notice, all these factors are modifiable factors. If you are in need of urgent precursinthesis, we might consider giving platelet or plasma for this patient. And the second relative contraindication are the surgical candidates, like patient with rupture, LV free wall post myocardial impaction, or rupture, aortic aneurysm, or localized effusion post open heart surgery. Actually, the better treatment of this patient are by surgical drainage rather than percutaneous drainage, because if we perform percutaneous drainage in this patient and causing relief of tamponade and rise of systemic blood pressure, this will enter a vicious circle of free bleed inside the pericardial sac again, and etc. So might be considered as a transient life-saving measure while transferring the patient to the surgeon. So how to perform pericardiosynthesis? Here is the kit of pericardiosynthesis, including sterile tap and local anesthesia, puncture needle, dilator, and 0.035 soft J-wire pigtail, and the drainage line including IV line, three-way stopcock, and urine bag, and 20cc syringes, and also tubes for further fluid analysis. We have six possible sites for drainage of pericardial fluid. Three are subcostal, direct subcostal, or just left or right parasyphoid. The most commonly used site is the left parasyphoid between the xiphoid sternum and the left costal rib. Second site is apical, but not well preferred because of higher incidence of possible lung injury or pleural injury causing pneumothorax, so it must be restricted to echo-guided procedure. And the lastly, parasternal approach. Usually done in the left parasternal space over the bare area of the heart to avoid inadvertent lung or pleural injury. Then here we start after getting informed consent from the patient and checking his coagulation profile. The patient is positioned in supine at 30 to 45 degrees to get benefit from gravity and get more fluid in the dependent inferior surface of the heart. This actually minimizes the risk of getting into the heart cavity itself. Then sterilization technique and local anesthesia and sterile probe cover for the echo. Then measuring the distance between the heart and the skin surface to anticipate the possible length of needle before getting into the pericardium, and second information is the orientation of the needle. Here we are in the subcostal view with the probe directed at 3 o'clock to the left of the patient, and we have the needle on the left side of the probe. When we translate this position into echo picture, we have here the probe expected to be at this point, and here is the liver, on the right side, and here is as your needle will come from this direction on the left side of the probe. So we have either echo assisted technique, where we perform initial echo, then we go blindly according to the data we get from echo, or better to go echo guided all over the procedure with continuous monitoring using this position. Next step will be advancing the needle slowly, 1 millimeter by 1 millimeter. Once getting across the skin, we tilt the needle 30 degree in order to pass below the costal margin. The direction of the needle along its course is directed towards the tip of the left shoulder, applying negative pressure over the syringe till we get characteristic pop when we get through the fibrous parietal pericardium. And once getting inside the pericardium and getting fluid inside the syringe, we stop at this point and fixing your. And then we have the most critical step, which is shaking the position of the needle. Is it inside the pericardial cavity or inside the RV or inside the heart cavity? We have several methods to make sure the position of the needle. First is echo method, where we inject 5 cc of agitated saline and checking the position of this fluid through echocardiography. As in this picture, we saw the agitated saline in the pericardial sac, then we are in the true pericardium. If it appears inside the RV only, then we are in the RV cavity and we should withdraw our. Second method is a pressure method, by connecting the needle to a pressure transducer. If we get a small amplitude wave like this pericardial wave, then we are in the pericardium. If we get RV tracing, then we are in the RV. Third method is injecting dye through the needle and tracing the dye via fluoroscopy. If we get the dye in the dependent area of the inferior surface of the shadow of the heart, then we are in the pericardium. If it is stagnant inside the heart shadow, this might be an RV. Next method is ECG method. Normally the pericardium is isoelectric, so if we applied an ECG electrode using a sterile alligator to the tip of the needle, we get this tracing of isoelectric ECG tracing. But in case the needle is touching or penetrating the heart wall, we will get a segmental elevation or frequent PVCs. So if we get the tracing, we should withdraw our needle a little. Then after confirming the needle position, we introduce the soft J-shaped 0.035 wire under fluoroscopic monitoring in two perpendicular view, preferably EB view and lateral view, then withdrawing our needle. And always remember, don't advance if you face any resistance. Then we get a 6 French dilator and dilate our track, then introduce the pigtail 6 French, usually pigtail catheter, over the wire as we see here. Then we get our samples for analysis, including cytology, histopathology, chemistry, and culture and sensitivity. Then we set this setup, which is the pigtail end connected using a three-way into a suction needle, and then a drainage system including IV set and a urine bag connected to each other. Then we rotate this stop cock of the three-way. When we rotate in this direction with this blind end facing the IV set, we are in the aspiration position with a suction of fluid from the patient. And when we need to evacuate the syringe, we rotate in the opposite direction so that this blind end is facing the pigtail catheter, and then we inject in this system, and doing this for several times till we get a drain of the pericardial fluid. after puncturing the pericardium, when I get this color, we have two possibilities. Either we have a hemorrhagic effusion and we are in the pericardium, or we are inside the RV and this is blood from inside the right ventricle. How to differentiate? Simply by knowing the hematocrit in this sample, if it is equal to the blood of the patient blood sample, so mostly we are inside the RV cavity. If it is less, mostly it is it might be pericardial effusion, with exception of RV of rupture free wall of the ventricle and rupture aortic aneurysm, where it might have a high or similar hematocrit level to the blood one. So the clinical scenario will also help. Second method is to put this fluid in a piece of gauze. Then if it is clot, so most likely it is from the right ventricle, and if it doesn't clot easily, mostly it is pericardial fluid. And always be in the safe side. So if you are in doubt after all this, withdraw your needle. Post procedure, it is a good practice to get tracing of the intrapericardial pressure post drainage. In this case, we can exclude effusive constrictive pulse physiology. So after drainage of the pericardial fluid, as if the pericardial pressure is still high, this goes with effusive constrictive pulse physiology, with the raised pressure caused by stiff pericardium rather than the fluid itself. After finishing the procedure, we fix the catheter with a suture and cover it with sterile dressing. Regarding prophylactic antibiotics, there is no consensus about putting the patient on prophylactic antibiotic, but in most cases we put the patient on anti-staph antibiotic as long as the drain is left in place. Then do chest x-ray post procedure is mandatory to exclude any lung complication like pneumothorax or hemothorax. When to remove the drain? When the output is less than 30 milliliter all over a 24 hour, and no residual effusion by echocardiography. And remember to do echocardiography before and after removal of the drainage. So after 72 hours and we're still having a high output drain more than 100 cc. So there is no procedure without a possible complication, and if you didn't have complications, then you didn't perform the number needed to get one. Always a rule in complication: expect the unexpected, then when it happens you will be ready. So what is the possible complication in this procedure? Simply during introduction of the needle, we might injure the left lobe of the liver, or we might injure one of the chambers of the heart, right atrium, right ventricle in case of subcostal drainage, or LV wall in case of apical drainage. We might also injure left anterior descending artery or left anterior mammary artery, but it is rather rare complication. Also, puncturing the pleura or the lung might cause pneumothorax or hemothorax, which is more common in the apical approach. A common syndrome called pericardial decompression syndrome, in which the patient might experience hypotension or pulmonary edema or even cardiogenic shock post drainage, mostly a very large amount of effusion. So it is a good practice to avoid drainage more than 1 liter of pericardial fluid and drain the rest on gradual manner rather than acutely to avoid this syndrome. There is multiple scenarios or theories for explanation of this syndrome. One of this is that during pericardial tamponade, there is high intrapericardial pressure, so the venous return is decreased, and the cardiac output is also decreased, and the body underwent a protective procedure to raise pressure, which is peripheral vasoconstriction. On relieving a large amount of pericardial fluid with drop of the intrapericardial pressure, the reverse occur, which is rapid rise in the venous return, so rise in the heart preload, but due to delayed recovery of the vasoconstriction state, the heart is still facing a large afterload. So the heart lies between a state of increased preload and afterload. So one of these symptoms might occur, like hypotension, cardiogenic shock, or pulmonary edema. So avoid drainage of very large amount of fluid acutely. So we have special situation we have when we draining the pericardial fluid and getting rapid reaccumulation. We have a possible solution in case of malignant pericardial effusion. We might inject a sclerosing agent inside the pericardium, like tetracycline. This might cause obliteration of the pericardial sac and decrease the recurrence rate. Second option is injecting a chemotherapeutic agent inside the pericardium, like cisplatin in case of lung cancer and Tyvaso in case of breast cancer. Another novel solutions in cases of repeated pericardial effusion in a rather frail patient who rejected from surgical approaches of pericardial window, something like that, we might do percutaneous pericardiotomy. The procedure has similar step like pericardial synthesis, a needle puncture in the subthyroid space, and introducing a rather stiff wire in this scenario, and then a balloon. Like the balloon mitral one, and then after positioning the balloon across the pericardial shadow, then we inflate it repeatedly to get rid of this waste. Then we constitute a communication between the pericardial sac and the pleural sac.